We are now at the first scientific and stakeholder panel, which we are having on this event today. The theme is the 1.5 climate target. What does the European society need from polar research? And I will hand over now to the chair of this panel. The chair is our colleague from EU-PolarNet, Björn Dahlbäck, who is the Director General of the Swedish Polar Research Secretariat, which is a government agency, and it is mandated to coordinate and promote Swedish polar research. Björn Dahlbäck has a PhD in microbiology. He had different positions, manager positions in his life, and he worked in the industry as far as I see. Now, as I already said, he's a partner in EU-PolarNet and the director of the Swedish Polar Research Secretariat. Björn, that's your turn now.
Thank you. Thank you, Nicole.
Can I use this microphone?
Yes, I'll try to use it. I need to switch it. Like this. With the help
of the glasses. Thank you. Good morning, or late good morning to everybody. I start with inviting my excellent panel. The five of you, or one, two, three, four, five, six of you. Yes, Tero is over there, so please take your seat and buckle up. I think we skip the safety instruction and go directly to the flight. So now the panelists are saying hello to each other. They haven't met before. Well, some of you know each other very well. I know that.
Yes.
And this is our panel for an hour or so. And a panel is a straight line. As you can see, they are sitting in a straight line. But I would like to point out that this line is curved here. And then it goes to the audience. So what we actually have is a round table. But the panel will be invited to start and say some, give a short presentation each on the theme that we almost see on the screen. There's something popping up there. So I'm going to do a very simplified, quick presentation of you. And if you don't agree, you can correct me when you do your short presentation. So we have Jannie Staffansson working for the Saami Council. And we have Peter Gibbs, weather forecaster. And you've been working at Antarctic and also overwintering. And we have Valérie Masson-Delmotte, among other things, author and co-chairing within EPCC. Peter Sköld, a professor in Sweden from an Arctic university. Tero Vauraste, CEO of the icebreaking company. And yet another CEO, Tom Armstrong, of a consulting company in the area of climate change. So this was my very simplified, maybe reduced presentation of you. This is the theme that we have been invited to give some thoughts on. And in my mind, this is one of the most important links that has been established this year, the so-called PP link, Paris and polar. We agreed things in Paris. What does this mean for polar research, for people living in the polar regions, and the way we use data from polar research? I think the link between Paris and what we do in the broader sense, the polar area, is of huge importance. Before I will stop with Jenny, but before I do that, I have some reflections. It says on my ticket, I flew here from Stockholm, it says 288 kilos carbon dioxide took me here. I looked at the participant list. Some of you walked here, some of you took a train, and somebody took the car. Well, let's say 100 kilos per person just to travel here. So equals 15 tons of carbon dioxide per this meeting. So what is the thinking about this? This is the amount of carbon dioxide that we just getting here are consuming. But I think the consumption should be related to the production. So we consume 15 tons, but what do we produce at the meeting? Yes, we do produce some carbon dioxide exhaling, but I'm not thinking of that carbon dioxide. This is a very well-known, even newly, quite new established concept. It's called, its acronym is, of course, an acronym because we are in the polar business. It's CPSS. Maybe some of you have heard of it. Carbon per sustainable solution. So CPSS should be less than X. And I must admit that X is still unknown, but we are working on it. If we take that to this meeting, the more creative things we say and the more sustainable solution we point at, the lower X will be and the better meeting it will be. So don't feel the pressure, dear panel, but we need to have a very low X. That means that you need to be very creative. And not only you, you have a responsibility to trigger the audience. So we leave the room with a very low X. CPSS, carbon per sustainable solution. And maybe in the format, I'm looking at Tom now, Tom Armstrong on the end. You will share the panel afterwards, and your title is European Priorities for Polar Research. And if we do this right, probably things from this panel could be fed into the panel that follows. If we talk about polar research in terms of actual research, then it's up to you to prioritize Tom in your panel later on. Okay, enough from me. Short thoughts and presentations from each of the panelists. And I think it's logical to start with Jannie Staffansson. Please, the floor is yours.
Council, as you heard. I work mainly with Arctic environmental policy issues in the Arctic Council. I have a background in chemistry, environmental chemistry and organic chemistry. But my main knowledge comes from my society, my reindeer herding community. I was born as a reindeer herding, in a reindeer herding family, and I belong to the generation of climate change. We were brought up with climate change as a topic, not maybe the term, but the fact and the reality is of climate change. I will never experience the good winters that my grandparents talked about, and I will never ever feel safe on the ice when I travel across it. That is due to climate change, but also to renewable energy and regulations of water systems. So we're here to talk about this today, the degree 1.5, the goal that was set out by scientists, asked for from the communities, and in Paris also supported by politicians. What do we need for achieving this goal? We need action now, and we need some serious actions. Not just the thoughts of them, and we need all to be involved in this, the communities, the industries, the policymaker, but also the scientists. We need serious action. We need to leave fossil fuel behind. We need to leave oil industry behind, And we can't continue to burn coal, Sweden. We need to leave all of this behind. And we need to work jointly towards that goal. Because we don't have a plan B. We don't have a planet B. And I know that's supported by scientists. I don't believe it's as supported by politicians, it seems. But that's a fact. No plan B, no planet B. We need to take care of this one we do have. So what do we need from scientists? We need 100% renewable energy. And with my beginning of this speech saying that, well, my people have suffered. My people have paid the blood money for renewable energy. We still do. We have hydropower dams. We're paying with windmill parks on our land. And I need renewable energy, but we need to be strategic about this. We need researchers and scientists and technology to adapt to this future. And we need to be planning it strategically to place the windmill parks, for example, on places where it's needed, close to industry, close to cities, not here on indigenous people's land, again paying for renewable energy in the name of climate change. We don't need to push out another sustainable traditional livelihood, another sustainable industry in order to pay for cities' power. We need to be tactical when we use power. We need to be tactical when we use energy. Otherwise, we can't make this goal. This is the community that are being pushed out from this land. This community has been living off of this land, leaving no traces for generations. It's not right to push them further. They have paid the blood price. They don't need to pay more than this. But when you're a researcher, you need to have the best knowledge available. The scientist took us to the moon. We didn't need to go to the moon, but we did. Because scientists investigated. They were supported by politicians. They were supported by society. They had the fundings for it, and they had the best available knowledge. This is not the fact when it comes to climate change today and researchers. We are leaving a huge, huge gap of knowledge outside. We do not include, we do not cooperate with indigenous peoples, those who actually knows the climate, knows the nature. We need to start working on this. With that said, we need the best available knowledge, but we need also to know our history as researchers. Many comes up to me, Jannie, we want to do this research. Sounds great. But these people, those are Sami. And they're hanging there like slaughtered animals in a Swedish institutions because researchers, because scientists came, dug them up, and wanted to do research on them. And this is what we remember. My grandmother, she was conducted research upon. Researchers came to her community and did research. And we still remember this. We have learned from history to not trust researchers. So you need to build relationships. And you need to have that in the fundings, when you apply for funding, to actually have the time, to actually have the priorities, to build relationships. Otherwise, we won't trust you. And trust is vital. Because the indigenous knowledge is nested within the indigenous communities. And that's the only way to access, and that's the only way to cooperate. So investigate and apply for funding. And then when you do, also take the time to actually get involved and to get to know and build relationship with the indigenous communities. Otherwise, we can't reach our goal of 1.9 degrees. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jannie. Now the round table is already established, so if somebody's sitting on something right now, it's okay. I just wanted to check one thing, Jannie. You said coal and then Sweden. Did you say that?
Yes, and, I did.
Okay, I think you're referring to that a Swedish state-owned company, Vattenfall.
Yeah, you
okay. they were allowed by the Swedish government to pass on the large brown coal industry in Poland to an industry consortia. I think that was what you were referring to, which was quite controversial.
Yeah, it is. We can't have that if we want to reach that goal.
Thank you, Jannie. And Peter is already here. Peter Gibbs, the floor is yours.
Thanks very much, John. I guess I'm here to talk about science communication, but I have to say that's one of the most powerful bits of communication I've heard for a long time. Yeah, it's very, very impressive. Antarctica, anybody that's been there will know, is a place that draws you back. And I was very lucky earlier this year to get the chance to go back, 30-odd years after I first set foot on the continent, as a young meteorologist back in the early 80s, working for 2 years on the British Antarctic Survey's Halley Research Station. And I managed to persuade the BBC, who I work for currently as a weather presenter, to send me back there to make a documentary for the BBC's Horizon science series on the science, the work that's done at Halley, and just to show and hut into what an amazing place it actually is. And I think we achieved that. An hour-long programme, it went out in May of this year. Response was fantastic. It was seen by around about 2 million people. It's been watched since on the iPlayer, the BBC iPlayer. During the trip itself, we managed to do lots of live interaction. Couldn't quite do video, unfortunately, because of the low bandwidth, but sent that video report, had live telephone communication with BBC TV News, with BBC Radio. In fact, I learned recently that as a result of the radio interviews, a chap had actually given up his day job as a mechanic and applied to go down to Halley. So it actually changed his life, what he actually heard during this programme. So I really hope it works out, otherwise I'm going to feel very, very guilty indeed. Lots of stuff online as well, and social media was a real revelation. We were able to communicate with people, get people to actually identify with the trip all the way through. It was a 6-week round trip, but through most of that time, we were actually able to engage with people on social media. Twitter particularly seemed to be a real hit, and it was fantastic to build up the interest in that way, answer questions. We ended up doing two ways with schools over the radio as well, over the telephone link from the ship. So a huge amount of outreach from one single trip, which made the sort of whole 6-week period really worthwhile. But I just want to talk about the trip from a scientist's perspective. We spent a lot of time on the ship together. One of the science subjects that we wanted to tackle in the programme was space weather, which of course is increasingly important for economic reasons, if nothing else, apart from the sort of the basic research side of things. Richard Horne, who is, I'm sure some of you have heard of Richard and know Richard, space weather scientist at the British Antarctic Survey, happened to be on the ship with us going down to Halley to actually visit the base. I think it was his second visit there. We had 10 days out of Cape Town down to Halley. It's quite a long time to spend with people cooped up on a ship. But it did give us the opportunity to have a real good talk with Richard around his subject. Simon, my director, who had an engineering background but not a science background, trying to get his head around the subject of space weather. And I remember one particular day when Richard was explaining about these highly energetic electrons, which was a real puzzle because they were trying to work out how these electrons were actually reaching these incredibly high energies, because the physics didn't seem to support it, but they were actually getting there in terms of finding out why this actually happened. And he said, yeah, and you know what, they can even take out satellites. We call them killer electrons. At which Simon's face absolutely lit up, the director. I've got my headline, that's going to grab people in. Richard's face fell at the same time. You could see him thinking, oh no, what have I done? What have I done? I've turned this into a tabloid operation. What are my peers going to think with me coming out with terms like that? So he was, I think it's fair to say, rather uneasy from that point on. The Shackleton, though, spends 3 to 4 months of each year in Antarctic waters. trekking back and forth from Cape Town or from the Falkland Islands through some of the roughest seas in the world, ploughing through sea ice, and the crew that actually manned the ship, plus one woman, I should say, have a pretty tough time. They work really hard for that 3 months. It's a difficult job. And quite rightly, you know, they ask the question, why do we do this? Why do we go through all this? Why do we spend all this money taking all this stuff down to this ridiculously remote place where you've got all these scientists sitting around doing these strange experiments? And so because we had so much time on the ship, we had evening entertainments, we had a series of talks, and one of the talks was Richard talking about space weather. And he used the term killer electrons to explain how satellites could be taken out by these things. Satellite communications could be taken out as a result. And the crew got it. They absolutely got it. And when he explained how it was important, the work he was doing at Halley, to understand why these things were happening, they absolutely got it. And I think from that point, Richard was sold on perhaps using a slightly different style of communication. In fact, talking to Richard after the trip, he said he learned a huge amount about how to communicate his work, his science, through spending so much time, first of all, with a media team. It meant we got to know each other. It meant that any suspicions, perhaps, that were there melted away once we got to know each other as people. He realised we were out there just to explain the science, not to do a hatchet job on it. And we gained his trust and we gained his confidence. But also mixing in with the crew, ordinary people, explaining his work to them as well. And I think it's very important as we look ahead to our aims of this meeting, this organisation, that communication is a vital, vital part of it. And there are good ways to do it. And please engage with the media, engage with ordinary people as well. Get your scientists out there just talking to ordinary people. Because when they see that you are people doing work that you love, then the message really gets across. And of course, being in polar science, we do have the advantage that if all else fails, you can just trot out the polar bears and penguins. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. So we have, on the question what the society needs from polar research, we have Jannie's urge for respect and trust, and we have Peter's stressing the outreach and interaction between society and research. And Valerie, what do you think we should take out from research, in polar research to society?
I would like to start from the Paris Agreement. And during the negotiation process of COP21, it was not possible to have an agreement if there was not an invitation formulated to the IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, to produce a special report on the impact of global warming of 1.5 degrees above pre-industrial levels and related global greenhouse gas emission pathways. Where does this invitation come from? It comes from the most vulnerable countries, from the most vulnerable communities in all regions of the world, including the Arctic, and it comes also from considerations of the most vulnerable ecosystems. So this invitation has been accepted by the IPCC panel during its last plenary session. The work has started. There has been a scoping meeting to define what could be an outline for this special report, in a cycle where there will be two other special reports, one on the ocean and the cryosphere in the context of climate change, that is relevant for polar research as well. A third special report on land use related issues, including greenhouse gas fluxes in terrestrial ecosystems. It is also relevant for polar research. And a main assessment report being produced within 2022. I would like to start by where do we stand now considering this issue of 1.5 degree global warming. In 2015, temperature during that year was already 1 degree above pre-industrial levels. The trend since 1900 is now estimated between 0.9 and 1 degree warming. Since the 1970s, global temperature has risen at 0.17 to 0.18 degrees per decade, and it's variable because of internal climate variability. Predictions are emerging based on the phase of Pacific decadal variability, And existing studies point to larger rates of warming for the coming decade. So this is where we stand now. And this morning it was also referred to where we stand in terms of atmospheric composition. We are getting out of the range of variability during the current interglacial period. We are entering into levels of warming that were encountered during past warm phases of the Earth, where we know from evidence that major changes occurred in polar regions north and south. What do we know about what could be the impact the climate responses for 1.5 degree warming? What do we have from existing future climate simulations? So far, limited information. In the last IPCC report, the existing future climate projections did not include pathways compatible with at least 50% of confidence with stabilizing global climate to less than 1.5 degrees. So research is being produced at the moment. When we reach 1.5 degrees, whether it's in 15 years in the future or the following decades, what happens? What happens for temperature? You have an example here for global warming per degree of global warming. And you can see, of course, Arctic amplification and also a delayed response, actually, for the southern hemisphere high latitudes. We know more and more about impacts for extreme events, for instance, but there are still a number of knowledge gaps. What will happen for the Arctic and Antarctic sea ice for 1.5 degree warming? What is the importance of an overshoot above this level and the length of this overshoot? How important are the rates of warming for permafrost and associated carbon feedbacks, and therefore the mitigation efforts that has to be produced to limit global warming? What will be the responses of glaciers and their implications for local communities and for global sea level? What are the thresholds for long-term committed deglaciation of the Greenland and Antarctic ice sheets? And there are a number of open questions there that are of global relevance for all coastal areas. From existing climate models, there is evidence for possibility of abrupt shifts associated with sea ice at both poles, the interplay with ocean circulation, but very limited knowledge on the range of temperatures associated with a growing risk of abrupt change. So I would like to stress that we need more knowledge from the past, when there was evidence for warmer than pre-industrial phases for reasons that were not linked with human influence at different rates of change. We need better monitoring. The Antarctic was stressed as a major gap in current understanding in the last IPCC report. And this is, of course, due to the lack of measurements. We need better process-based understanding. We need improved models for polar regions. And we need to work with local communities to understand what are their needs so that the assessments will be delivered and useful for local adaptation processes. So just to finish, I would like to introduce you with the outline that was considered for a special report on 1.5 global warming. It was noted during the last IPCC Bureau meeting and will be discussed at the next plenary meeting next month. And it is built across disciplines, across IPCC working groups, a framing and context, of course, and then the assessment of mitigation pathways compatible with 1.5 degree warming in the context of sustainable development, the impact of 1.5 degree global warming on natural and human systems, and what is meant there is also the avoided impacts. If you have more ambitious mitigation, what are the avoided impacts and therefore the benefits of a strengthened action? What are the options for strengthening the global response to the threat of climate change, considering both adaptation and mitigation? How to implement these options, these solutions, so approaches for implementation. And what you can see here is that the key issue associated with this question is an issue of rates of changes, rates of climate change and our ability to respond to that for human societies and for ecosystems, but also rates of transformation and our ability to transform our societies, our energy systems, our cities, our agricultural systems in time so that we can limit global warming. And finally, an overall assessment of all the complex dimensions sustainable development and the sustainable development goals, poverty eradication and reducing inequalities in the context of both 1.5 degree global warming and the responses to this warming level. And with that, I would like to finish. And for those who are curious about this process, on the IPCC website for the preparation of the next session of the panel, you have a report from the scoping meeting. And I would like also to stress that there will be a scoping meeting for the special report on the ocean and the cryosphere in Monaco, beginning of December. That is also an opportunity to frame both the societal needs for research and the emerging knowledge from the science community that is globally and locally relevant. Thank you.
Thank you, Valérie. A question on the cryosphere, Valérie, the cryosphere and the ocean work, which will be a scoping exercise soon. When there is a document planned to be delivered when?
I thought my 5 minutes were over and skipped the last slide that was about the timeline and a little technical. So the special report on 1.5 degree is scheduled for September 2018 in time to inform the preliminary stocktake of the Paris Agreement. And the other special reports on ocean cryosphere and land use are scheduled for 2019.
Thank you. Any question directly to Valérie? We take it in the roundtable discussion. And now, Peter Sköld, Umeå University, an Arctic university in Sweden.
Yes, thank you, Björn. And first, I just like to add one small piece to the introduction. I'm invited here as president of IASSA, the International Arctic Social Science Association, and that will also explain to some extent the perspectives that I present to you today. As a social scientist, I really would like to say the European society, what is the definition? But we will not go into those details because it would be too complicated. Do I shift on this one? Ah, good. You are familiar with these slides. They illustrate communication. It's very important to tell the world that the Arctic is important, not least research-wise. And a very pedagogical metaphor is the picture to the left, the coal miner bringing the canary bird down to the mine. And when the bird was dizzy, even died, the miners realized that it was certainly time to take a few steps back, if not ram out of the mine. And the Arctic is then, of course, the canary bird of the world. And if the Arctic is not well, the world has certain reasons to take steps back. And that is what we should be about to do right now. And it's very important to communicate this message. Also, we can ask ourselves, what kind of an image do we communicate about the Arctic? One, to explain the climate situation and the global warming has to do with ice and polar bears, but it's certainly my duty to remind everyone that the Arctic is also a place where 4 million people live, and there are good reasons, as Jannie explained to us too, to be concerned with the development in the Arctic region per se. Mm-hmm. Yeah, let's see. Consequences. It's also very important to communicate what happens in the era of global warming. We get reports most every day. I think most people are well informed about the terrible consequences. There are good reasons to continue to communicate this message, though. I just want to put to your attention one consequence that has popped up lately and is a really terrible one. The consequences of melting permafrost. We do know that methane gas is released, but it has been put to our attention lately that there are viruses in this ice too. Recently, anthrax virus was released in the Yamal-Nenets region of Russia. People died, a lot of reindeer died, and the ground was devastated for a long time. We know from 100 years ago and the Spanish flu that people were buried in the ice. There is certainly influenza virus of a terrible kind left in the ice. And possibly even worse, what happens if smallpox virus is released? Do you remember smallpox? It's the only infectious disease that humankind has eradicated by itself through vaccination. It killed hundreds of millions of people. Every person before vaccination had smallpox and then died or was immunized, as with all other childhood diseases. There is no protection against smallpox today. We stopped to vaccinate in the 1970s, so we are all vulnerable. And I can tell you that our modeling showed that the effect of a released smallpox virus should be terrible. Politics, then, is a very important issue. I choose this image. There was a report released just the other week where some prominent Swedish people contribute. It's former ministers, it's important CEOs, it's think tank leaders, etc., etc. And they were giving the question, what about climate politics if you were the prime minister? And the list they provide is not controversial at all. You're all familiar with these topics. We hear all the time about the fossil-free society, cost efficiencies, etc., etc. But I think these topics frame very well the challenges that research should also address, because these are some of the most important areas to address. And I will not go into the details here. I think you can read the list for yourself. But one thing is very interesting, and that is the local and the global in combination. And as far as I see it, this is a key issue to understand, because it also links the individual to the global system. And we should not forget that we have global warming due to human activities. Nothing that popped out by itself. It's us that are to blame. We caused it, our behavior, and now it's time to change it. It's time to improve it. And it has certainly a lot to do with how we organize politics, legal systems, and communities at the local level. Key issues if we want to get somewhere. I'm very pleased to hear everyone talking about collaboration. I think it's a very good game plan, that this is definitely what we must do. We can see the collaboration resulting from the Paris COP21 meeting. We can see results coming out of the collaboration in the Arctic Council. We can see the great international collaborations on the research vessels, bringing researchers from many different countries together in a unified ambition to produce relevant research results. And we have the scientific organizations, IASSA and IASSA here, UArctic could be there also if we want to list the organizations with observer status to the Arctic Council. And this is so good. This is the way to go. But is the list of acronyms too long now? Do we have too many collaborative initiatives? Are there reasons to ask ourselves, is there a synergy effect that could be found if we rationalized the efforts from all these different collaborations? I think it's soon time for researchers to ask these questions to themselves. And then, I've been in this business for 30 years. It's a rather long time. Maybe because of that, I am getting a bit impatient. I want to see results. I want to see research that is solution-oriented. This is not a critique to ground or basic research in a long-term perspective. I know how important that is, and we should certainly continue to do it. I have a background in historical demography. I know what long-term prognosis is of Earth. They are very crucial. But I also want to see results. I want to see new research projects that at least present an ambition for a more short-term solution too, to say that give us the resources and we will change something, we will improve something. That is a very crucial aspect for the approach. And there is also good reasons to include more, and we see that happen, the social impact of research. We talk a lot about bibliometrics and quotation indexes, etc., etc. That is important. Altmetrics is important. That is how well we do in social media. We can measure that too these days. But I want to see people explaining what kind of a social impact they have, how they change the societies to get to a sustainable solution. And there are such a lot of good research efforts out there doing exactly that, and I encourage them to continue. Thank you.
Peter, your point that the risk that we wake up pathogens from permafrost, to your knowledge, is there a huge increase in the research on that risk right now?
Yes, there is actually. I'm not aware of all the initiatives, but I can tell that much, that the Research Council Nordforsk financed four large projects just recently, and one of them, the Klimt project, is focusing on exactly this, and it involves 50 researchers from all over Europe and the Arctic region, and I really look forward to see what they will produce.
Permafrost is breaking up, but another way of breaking the ice is using icebreakers. Tero.
Well, thank you very much. I think we were faced with a question by the chairman to provide an X, and nobody provided yet an X, but I have an X.
Very good.
And this X, I think, solves the whole problem of our CO2 emissions, because I just received an email 1 hour ago that finally the world's ever first LNG-powered icebreaker will be delivered tomorrow to our company. So that's going to save the CO2 emissions of this whole team.
Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. So we're faced with a question that what does the European society need from polar research? Well, first of all, what's the context of the European society here? Is it EU? I think no. I think we have to be inclusive and include also other European countries, Norway, Iceland, Greenland, and also Northwestern Russia into this dialogue and to this question. And let's also remember that the 1.5 degrees target is actually depending upon activities outside the Arctic, 99.9%, not within the Arctic. We're all aware of this, but this is so often forgotten, where the implications within the Arctic are becoming as a result of actions outside the Arctic. But let's frame this on the EU Arctic policy and then the UN agenda. And I will come up with some issues around the infrastructure and then final conclusions for the research. Well, first of all, the EU Arctic policy has three main objectives. It's protecting and preserving the Arctic in cooperation with the people who live here or there. And this is, by the way, a good question you so often hear when we discuss about indigenous peoples. You hear that we southerners, I say myself that I'm a southerner coming from Helsinki, even though it's about 60 degrees latitude, to discuss about the indigenous peoples, to discuss about them. I think it's a wrong approach. It's not an inclusive approach. Think about it. Second, promoting sustainable use of resources. And thirdly, international collaboration and cooperation, which is what this is all about. So I think it's great that the industry has been invited to this dialogue here today, and it's of high importance. Well, secondly, the EU Arctic policy also recognizes the UN Agenda 2030, where you recall that there are 17 different recommendations, and I will give you three goals which are related to the infrastructural developments. Goal number 8, that's promote sustained, inclusive and sustainable economic growth, eradicating poverty, which we heard today, full and productive employment, and decent work for all. Okay? Then we have goal number 9, build resilient infrastructure, promote inclusive and sustainable industrialization and foster innovation. Okay? And finally, goal number 12, which is to ensure sustainable consumption and production patterns. And since the EU Arctic policy recognizes this, we can say that within the EU Arctic policy, these goals are some of the goals of the EU Arctic policy. Well, we have been setting the scene for this event for 4 topics, and those have been the climate change, the energy security, innovation, and economic growth. And also, if you look into the European society and the global value chains within this, here comes first conclusion or first recommendation. If you look into the developments within the Arctic, most of the business developments are lacking economies of scale, which means that we should link the change of the economies within the Arctic to the economical change outside the Arctic. So we cannot discuss the Arctic as an island or as a remote place, because the economies of scale are lacking due to the fact that it's a remote area and not that much activity. Well, secondly, you look into the Arctic, more than 60% of the Arctic is oceans. So the maritime connections will be of high interest in the future, and that means that we really need to look into the emissions caused by shipping and other maritime activities. And as said, there is only one European indigenous people, that is the Sami people, so we must include the Sami people, and I'm not saying them, within the economical value chains. Let me give you an example. Finland has a productivity issue, let us put it that way. The country is not doing very well. But you look into the production from Lapland, it's 3% of the Finnish people, and they provide more than 10% of the export. So that is quite good productivity, and that is not including the travel industry at all. Energy security, another issue here. There we come into the question of renewables within the Arctic. The local energy developments are in a bad shape within the Arctic. You go to the Mackenzie Delta area up in Inuvik, you're sitting on the world's richest oil and gas basin, and yet simultaneously you bring in oil and gas by ships. Doesn't make sense at all. So we really need to have a look into the opportunity of producing renewable energies locally within the Arctic communities. That is my recommendation number 2. Digitalization as an opportunity. So let us get a practical example. There are around 110 icebreakers in the world, and their utilization is maybe 30 or 40%. So with the help of digitalization, perhaps we could use these resources much more efficiently. Simultaneously, today we discussed about the opportunities of weather prediction, which is of high importance. Again, utilization the icebreaker fleet much more efficiently. So what do we need from polar research, the European society? 1, information on engineering on the local renewable energies instead of imported energies. 2, information on developing sustainable economical chains, how to link the Arctic businesses to the global value chains in order to create added value. And thirdly, research on how to introduce funding mechanisms whereas added value is unavailable due to lack of economics of scales. So how can Finland and our company contribute into this? We've discussed about the collaboration. The Arctic or the White House Science Ministerial, which will take place this week, will have one of the Finnish initiatives, and that is the Arctic 100 expedition. whereas the Finnish Minister of Foreign Affairs and the Finnish Minister of Culture and Education and Arctia will open up an opportunity for the whole Arctic research community to participate into an Arctic expedition in 2017, when Finland will take over the chair of the Arctic Council and also have its 100 year centennial. So let me put this to the distribution, and to those who are interested, please have one of these, and we'd be happy to discuss this further as well. So Björn, if you can help and
put those forward.
So that will be one of the deliverables from Finland to the Arctic Minister, Arctic Science Ministerial in the White House. So to conclude, collaboration is one of the themes of the Arctic Economic Council, where research and businesses should work together, because we have seen that we have had research doing research for researchers, politicians doing politics for politicians, and businesses doing businesses for businesses. That doesn't make sense. And it's very important that the businesses and the industry is involved within these discussions, because whatever the developments are within the Arctic in terms of developing the infrastructure, in the end, it's more or less the private companies who will be acting as the operators. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Tero. In May next year,
yes.
Finland will take over the chairmanship of the Arctic Council.
That's right.
I know you touched upon it, but could you be even more concrete from a business opportunity point of view from the Finnish side? What do you see? What kind of opportunities do you see when Finland takes the chairmanship?
Well, it's really a broad question, but if you narrow it down to the opportunities of businesses and the infrastructural developments, I would take perhaps two issues. I would take the engineering know-how, both in maritime activities and infrastructural activities. And secondly, it's the human resources and capacity building, whereas I think within all the Nordics we have great education systems, and especially in terms of having improved collaboration and better education up in northern areas, that would be the second one.
What I've seen from the program and the sort of ambition that Finland has when it takes over the chairmanship, I think it's right on the theme of this panel, linking Paris to polar research and environment. So that will be very interesting to see how Finland succeed in that. Tom, please, the floor is yours. Tom, I was on my way to joke with you, now I'm doing it. So you recently did a huge career leaving the White House.
I did?
Yeah, establishing a consultancy company.
Right, yeah, that was a big move. I'm still paying the price for that, I guess. I want to thank EU-PolarNet for having me here today to be part of this group. This great panel, great topic about what we're doing in the Arctic impacts and is impacted by the COP21 agreement. You know, having done this for 25 years, getting to where we got to in Paris was a huge achievement, just an incredible achievement. I've been fortunate enough to work with people like Thomas Stocker, Chris Field on IPCC Working Group 1, Working Group 2. I co-led the U.S. delegation for AR5 Working Group 2. And it just amazes me that in the science community especially, but also the policy community, that we have the ability for that many countries to come together, Thomas, and come to agreement. And you know, people argue about watered down priorities or mandates, but just getting that much of the globe to agree, to sit down and talk, is miraculous. And what was accomplished in Paris for COP21 is a major step forward. Celebrate the victory, but let's talk a little bit about the challenge of, we've got an agreement, where do we go from here? What does that mean in terms of pledge and commitment? What do I do to advance? I'm sorry, no, we have practical matters of challenge. See, this happens to me every time. I think it's the smallpox being released from the melting permafrost. Use the arrow, of course. So, Marcus Carson earlier today, I like to pick on Marcus because he actually cost me $17,000 in Stockholm one time. It's another story. Had a really interesting question for Paolo earlier today, and that was, and I'll paraphrase, how does human behavior affect our ability to effectively deal with climate change? And believe me, I'll get back to the relevance of this to the topic here, because I think, frankly, the rate limiting factor in our ability to deal with climate change isn't the science. I think there's a lot of great science out there. I know there is. And I know that that information is directly relevant to making decisions about how to combat the impacts, effects, and consequences of climate change. But there's a rate limiting factor in our ability to communicate, understand, and agree on what the problem actually is and what we're going to do about it. And that question of how does human behavior affect our ability to effectively deal with climate change is fundamental to my talk. The talk will be broken into two fundamental aspects itself. First, I'll talk a little bit about, in order to deal with that issue of human behavior, we need to understand the policy context and the decision-making context of climate change itself. And setting that policy issue context, something I used to do at the White House and the Office of Science and Technology Policy, was to recognize that the Arctic is rapidly changing. And it's not just rapid change, but the acceleration in the rate of change, the second derivative, is significantly increasing. So we're chasing the tail of a problem that's running down the tracks and speeding up. It's one of the few ecosystems on the planet, nobody knows this better than you, where the impacts and effects of human-induced climate change really, truly, acutely can be readily observed, including possibly the display of nonlinear behavior. And finally, the effect of climate change-oriented policy, the need for that strategy, includes sustained engagement between scientists and decision makers, as well as what I call a multivariate response in order to be successful. And I'll talk about what that means right now. Well, first, you know, some of the issues we've been talking about in terms of the science related to the Arctic that's relevant, and the polar regions writ large, Antarctica as well. Here are four of the fundamentals that people have already talked about. But in terms of the major policy options, what I've learned over the last 15, 20 years is that mitigation, the actual reduction of emissions of greenhouse gases and adaptation should not be thought of as being different. Rather, they're two pieces of the same puzzle. If you want to successfully adapt, you want to lower your risk by having successful and aggressive mitigation, and vice versa. Successful and aggressive mitigation is only going to be helpful if we're also ready and prepared to recognize that it alone is not the silver bullet to get us to where we want to go. And I will argue in a second, also for the COP21 agreement, that we've got to be ready to include a very well-orchestrated and coordinated adaptation strategy at all levels. Not from the top down, but more from the bottom up, where impacts and effects are felt, all the way rolled up to where the funding resources and the policy mandates are made. A third thing we need to be talking about, whether you like to talk about it as a scientist or a politician or a policymaker or not, is climate engineering. And I'll get into why that's so important in just a minute. But there, my good friend and my former boss, John Holdren, the president's science advisor, always wanted to make sure that whenever we gave a talk, we talked about the fourth policy option, and that's suffering, and that's doing nothing. Doing nothing is a decision in and of itself, and it's typically the worst decision you can make. And John always referred to it as suffering, and I will never forget that point. And then finally, in terms of policy options, we need to develop into a new paradigm, both as sovereign nations, but as one global community. And that is that we need an integrated policy approach. We need to do all these things except suffer together. Now, in terms of the pledge, and I stole the slide and I forgot to give it the credit where the credit's due. It's been in several major sources and I can acknowledge that later. But just if you look at that one little box there, that's sort of that ochre color, that's where the pledges are to 2030. That's the wedge of pledge or pledges. if you look at the green box going out from the different representative carbon pathways up to 3.5 degrees Celsius or 2.0 degrees Celsius on the downside, the RCP 2.6 essentially, that green wedge, as well as all of what's above that going up to business as usual right now, is there to remind us that the commitments don't stop with the COP21 agreement that we just, hopefully, your country ratified. It has to go on all the way to 2100, essentially, in order for this to work. It is a set of ratcheting up agreements by the countries to commit to try to lower their greenhouse gas emissions and CO2, essentially, to zero. And that's what that RCP 2.6 line shows going down to 2.0, is you're effectively getting to the point where we have an emission-free globe. Now, Valérie showed something I think that is a better illustration than what I've got here. This is from Smith et al. 2015. It's been in several other publications, unfortunately, since then. It's rather disturbing to me as a scientist and a former policymaker, and what it essentially says is in order to get to where we want to go through emission reduction over the course of the rest of this century, that is the area of in the box of around 2.0 to 1.5, we are going to take ourselves into the negative emission zone, or the negative emission technology zone. It basically essentially argues that we are challenged, even if we are to reduce our greenhouse gas emissions to zero over the course of the century, we're going to be very challenged to get to 2.0 degrees C, let alone 1.5. Some people would argue it's even worse than that. I'd rather be an optimist. But in terms of what I talked about before, when it comes to that multivariate or that integrated policy approach, what that last slide really tells us, regardless of the argument of one model run versus another one in the ensemble, is we had damn well better be prepared to have more than just a mitigation and adaptation set of policy options available as, again, sovereign nations, but as a global community. Because right now we're on the verge of needing to actually take CO2 and other greenhouse gases out of the atmosphere as part of a climate engineering policy portfolio. How we do that? Through biologic sequestration, geologic sequestration, CDR, or solar radiation management. That's up for debate and discussion. Issues about scalability, about whether or not we have the science behind us to do it, those are other issues. But I think that, let me go back one. Yeah, this slide here, from the National Academy's report in 2016 on climate intervention. You can see the challenges of climate, what they came to was basically what I would want to tell you, and that is you have to have a portfolio of actions with varying degrees of risk and efficacy. There's no substitute for mitigation and adaptation, but be prepared to do other things. Never rely on a silver bullet mentality by politicians to tell you that we can wait and then intervene our way out of this. That would be a disaster. Albedo modification, for example, those strategies currently are limited by unfamiliar and unquantifiable risks and governance issues. And any intervention in the Earth's climate should be informed by a far more substantive body of scientific research than what we have available at present. And as a policy guy, again, the thing that keeps me up at night is taking action without having the science underpinnings behind us and actually causing secondary impacts and effects that might be a problem bigger than what we were trying to solve. And if you think that doesn't exist, take a look at the big levees that are 26 feet above the city of New Orleans, created by the Army Corps of Engineers. As Sir Francis Bacon once said, nature to be commanded must be obeyed. And that comes back to me time and time again when I think of this last bullet. Without the science underpinnings, we are in a bad position to be taking any policy option that isn't really well understood. So I'm sure I've used up all my time, but what I wanted to talk about as the second part of the framework about how to help educate and modify or move human behavior towards being more proactive in taking action to combat the impacts and consequences of climate change. We've been working in the private sector as well as the public sector, hand in hand with the White House, on the development of a science and decision-making process. And a lot of what I have in the slides, the language is just basically saying you really need full-time engagement between decision makers at all levels and the science community, working in an iterative way, communicating effectively, not just talking past each other, to develop basically a map of how the science community thinks about going from the climate sectors, the drivers, into impacts, effects, and consequences. That in this slide, and it's a little hard to see in this neural network, is going left to right. On the right, you start with decision makers at a very detailed level, trying to figure out what are their immediate resource management or political policy resource challenges and issues that they face. Start rolling those ideas up from right to left, and you end up in that box of area we call development of adaptation actions. And this is specifically for adaptation in this case, but I would argue for any of the policy options I've described, being able to converge on consequences is the place where the science intersects the decision-making the most effectively and the most articulately. And it's by doing this in an iterative way, from left to right, right to left, whatever you want to call it, but together as one community, I think we can get to the place where, at the end of the day, the science is more useful and usable and relevant to decision-making. And by doing that, by making it more useful and relevant, and by everybody having a common understanding of what it is the science community can do, and what, frankly, right now we can't, as well as the need for additional science in order to help inform the decision makers. If we can get here, I honestly, sincerely believe we can start to influence in a positive way behavior, human behavior, such that people that are currently skeptics, they really don't know about climate change and what's causing it and what we can do about it. They can be educated. And I think they're the biggest population of people out there right now beyond the believers. The climate naysayers, the people that are the deniers, those are people that you'll never convince because frankly, they already know the true answer in most of those cases. They just, for political reasons or other reasons, are just not gonna agree with you. But I think we can make a big difference in our behavior this way. And I think that's gonna be necessary in order to implement that multi-phase policy process that I talked about. And that was the purpose of this last slide, is to show that there is a bridge that we can build between the science community and the decision-making community. And in doing so, I honestly believe from a scientist viewpoint, and I'm one myself, that we might actually herald a new renaissance in science and science information and science education. Because by showing the direct relevance of what we're doing to any and all stakeholder issues, decision-making issues, I think people will get a much better idea and demonstration of the true power and value of the great work that many of you do. And I go back to that 4-minute movie earlier. We owe it to the people of this globe to do this, but even immediately, we owe it to all those dedicated scientists who have taken their whole career and worked so hard at trying to make a difference. We've got to help find a roadmap to make that difference. Thank you.
Thank you, John. So, the panelists were invited to reflect and present on the theme, what does the European society need from research? And now you sit and listen very politely on the other presentations. So first I will ask the panelists if there are any reflections you have when you've listened, and then, dear audience, part of the round table, it's up to you to oppose, comment, reflect, or whatever you would like to do. In the panel, do we have any reflections after this very broad and nice exposé we had on the theme? Yes, Jenny.
Oh, you're supposed to have this microphone.
You, thank you. I want to thank you, my fellow panelists, for having great presentations and for also bringing a lot of good things up to view. One of the things that I heard from Peter was he brought up the permafrost melting and the loss of of a lot of reindeers and also people. The interesting thing with this is that the indigenous peoples of that area knew that that was not a good location. It was hidden in their oral history. They knew that that was a hunted place not to set foot on. But due to different circumstances, that was their only option at the time. They took a risk. And knowing this within their indigenous history, within this knowledge. And, well, it wasn't a very good result of that risk-taking. But it's interesting to put that to focus as well. That different knowledges can be brought up from these communities and can help with research to help where should we look. Are these histories because of maybe sicknesses or diseases, or are there all other histories that are based upon these decisions of not entering those places? And also a quick another point that the Sami people are not the only indigenous peoples in Europe. We also have the Ice people, the Inuit, not to be forgotten.
Thank you, Jannie. Thank you. Some other reflections from the panel before I let in the audience. Peter S is sitting or something.
Well, it is a reflection, but it ends with a question to Tom, I think. I'm very happy to hear that many of us address human behavior, because that is a challenge. And I'm not sure, but did anyone mention consumption? Because that is a key word, and there are good reasons if we should address the European society to ask them about consumption behavior. And I just want to put to your attention the happiness paradox. Have you heard about it? People who are unhappy wish for more material objects, and when they get them, they are still as unhappy, because the one who had them have something new. So the meaning of life is not consumption, if you ask me, and that is a lesson we need to teach. But if we should change this, I agree that political decisions are crucial. And then, how should we tackle the fact that the political system is so short-term? Politicians don't dare to take decisions, because then they will not be re-elected. How should we solve that? Do you have a comment to that?
Well, if you pass on the microphone to Tom, and Tom will give you a very straight answer, and after that, Tero has the microphone, and after that, the audience.
So I will make it. It is working, okay. I agree with you. The political half-life quandary that we have, I can only speak for the United States, of 2-year re-elections, let alone the executive 4-year re-election, makes it very difficult to come to any long-term agreement on anything, because those decisions are outside the political half-life of the individuals that are, frankly, first and foremost, in many cases, interested in re-election. I'll leave it at that.
Coming back to your question about the consumption and production, the answer is digitalization. We have new shared economies like Airbnb, Uber, and many others, and hopefully in the future we do have IceBnB as well, where we can share resources within icebreaking.
Thank you, Tero. And now the audience, you're sitting on things, reflections, comments, questions to the panel. Well, yes, a microphone to our colleague that has worked in Finland, Sweden and Norway.
Yeah, just to Jannie, you have all reason to be very proud, because you represent the only nationality in Europe of which I know which is actually net having a cooling impact on the climate. Your reindeer are preventing the shrub encroachment and encroachment of this birch brush, keeping the tundra as the high albedo ecosystem. For my three nationalities, Finnish, Swedish and Norwegian, I am equally suited to be very ashamed, because these nationalities have driven negative campaign on reindeer husbandry, and they forced the Sami to split their activities across according to current national borders, which they didn't like to have there, and which actually are dividing the ranges in a very, very suboptimal way. We are harassing them. instead of helping them. That's the very fact. Just anything has been said, current Helsinki Sanomat, not we are harassing them, especially badly in Finland. So we should change that. And Björn knows who wanted to have results. Yes, we should have results. We Nordic people should. We are famous for our ability to collaborate. Why not collaborate on this simple issue, which is not a big thing economically, but can be a big thing for climate? The current increase in brushwood on Finnmark beta is so severe that it actually absorbs now so much more solar radiation than it would be absorbed in more tree estate, that would melt 1 cubic kilometer of ice each late winter. And this is not a joke, it's a calculation of Finnish meteorological FMI. So,
thank you. Margareta, yes, you would like a microphone and you have some thoughts to deliver to us. Please present yourself. Not...
Yeah. Okay. Hello everyone, my name is Margareta Johansson. I come from Lund University, but I represent Interact, which is a network of research stations around the Arctic. I'm not going to take your time about that. But Jannie, I fully agree with you that it is very important to have indigenous people's knowledge back to, well, sort of together with the traditional scientific way of doing things. But I'm not really 100% agreeing with you that we are not doing that, because in the Arctic Climate Impact Assessment that was released in 2004, which is of course an assessment that feed into the IPCC, for example, we had indigenous people knowledge, at least in the terrestrial ecosystem chapter, which was not 50-50, but it was a very big part of it, if you look at it. And when we continued with the SWEPA, which was the Snow, Water, Ice, Permafrost in the Arctic assessment that was published in 2011, we had a Saami reindeer herder that was a lead author on a chapter that was, it was excellent. I think one of the comments we got from the reviewers was, there is reindeer in each of the pages. It was about snow. And of course, snow is very important for reindeer when we look at the impact on other things. But it was almost, yeah, we were criticized that it was too much. But so I think we have, at least we have tried to involve because we think it's very important. But have you got other suggestions how to involve? I mean, we have research projects that directly involve indigenous people's knowledge as well, not just inviting a person to come and listen, because of course that's not involving. But have you got other suggestions how to involve? Because of course we are keen on doing it, but if you can add to what we're already doing, that would be great.
So we are on the we and them theme, and the question is, we are talking about we and what should we do more together. Jannie, do you want to respond to that?
The thing, I know that there are a lot of documents noting and also bringing indigenous knowledge up to the front, but it's happening backwards. It's like, usually researchers, when you are trying to cooperate with another research lab, for example, or with another institution, you don't just go into the to their lab, open their computer, extract their knowledge and leave. That's quite rude. And that's what's happening right now. These relationships are not established in the beginning of the research. And the questions, when you come to the communities, you have already got your questions. You're not involving us at an early stage to set the questions for the research, for example. And that's something that happens more often than it does not. Of course, we have some researchers doing a great job with this and really trying, but it's not the general thing that's happening, unfortunately. And also, that's the same thing in many, many researchers' view from in the Swedish side as well. I know that they're approaching in a late stage, extracting knowledge and then leaving and not coming back. Unfortunately. So relationship building at an early stage. But with that said, it's also hard to establish relationship when there's no one to really turn to. So we need to have our own institutions that can deal with these things and can direct it in a proper way, maybe.
I would say thank you, Margareta and Jannie, to make it so clear that we have an issue here. I mean, it's so easy to solve it, and there are good examples when it works, and there are examples where it actually does not work. And I believe the only way is to sit down and solve it and talk about it. So thank you for bringing it up, Margareta. Marcus, yes.
Again, I couldn't not follow up with Tom here. But I just want to say that Yanni's comment really emphasizes how resource extraction can be done very badly in a whole range of different ways, and it can be done well. But when it's done well, it's not resource extraction, I think, in that sense. Tom, what you said, apart from the overcharges, he buys me a beer and it costs. Never go there again. But you mentioned the word roadmap, which we hear a lot in the European Union context, because we're looking for a clear path to get to the behavioral change that's required to solve this problem that we've created by burning stuff. Right? But earlier you pointed to something I think that makes the roadmap idea not so useful. And you're talking about an iterative process. That this is a kind of process that requires us to keep on coming back and reevaluate where we're at on that path. And that means there's not a map. I wonder if you could take that another step, because I think that's really a part of the sort of the key to getting to where we need to get to.
It sounds like a key, but it's a key question that needs quite the quick response, because we are wrapping up.
Better hope you're not on my panel, that's all I got to say. So, you know the answer to that question. In thinking of a roadmap, people think of a drive from point A to point B. And we're talking about a whole new dimension of, some of us call it adaptive management, you can call it whatever it is, but it's a period of pause, reflection, and sort of reassessment of what's going on. And that's a big part of the iterative dialogue and iterative process that needs to occur. This actually, Margaret, also goes to your question as well. There's never been, in any of the assessments I've ever been involved in, and I wasn't involved in ACIA, but I've talked to Carell about it, there's never been a case, an ideal case, where we started with the stakeholder. And I mean, really started with the stakeholder and then moved from there. And what we have to realize is that, even if you argue with me in a minute, I'll make the point that it doesn't matter where we start to begin with. It would be ideal to start with the stakeholder and then take that iterative cyclical process. But if we have a sustained process and we agree that we're going to follow that adaptive management track and reassess, then we will come full circle to the point where, in this case, the Saami Council or any indigenous person or any local or political person can actually engage immediately and directly. The real problem with the sustained process is resources. And it's not just money, it's human capital as well. I can't tell you how many people in all the assessments I've done, including the US National Climate Assessment and IPCC comments, that go through stakeholder fatigue or science fatigue and assessment fatigue, including Thomas now, who's trying to hide from us at IPCC. It just takes the life out of you. And to sustain that level of engagement takes a lot more than just money.
Beautiful. Thank you, Tom. Are you sitting on a very quick response, Margareta, or you're...
No, I'm happy.
Margareta is happy. So the program is now, we have two reflections, comments from the audience, and then we will wrap up. And I will say, I will ask you in the panel, now, the question was, what does the European society need from polar research? And each of you should choose one receiver. And you choose receiver, it could be anybody, your father or prime minister or research funding agency. You choose one receiver and one advice on the theme, what does the European society need from polar research? Carlo.
Carlo Barbante from National Research Council of Italy and University of Venice. We are dealing with polar regions and we have not to forget Antarctica. Antarctica is a continent of about 14 million square kilometers, 30 cubic million of ice, and under a changing climate, there will be a lot of concern about that. And as a European citizens, we have to carefully think about that. And I want to have a comment from the panel on that.
So the proposal or the urge is do not forget Antarctica. That is, I mean, we are the that, well, I shouldn't respond. Is anybody sitting on, because it has been a lot of, I agree, a lot of Arctic, the theme is polar. We've seen graphs from Antarctic as well as on the from the Arctic, but still 72% of the time, no, 82, we have been talking about Antarctic. Peter, you were totally Antarctic.
And certainly what I found from doing the programme was don't underestimate how little people know about Antarctica. Many people don't even know there's a vast continent down there, don't know that it's totally ice-covered, that there's virtually no land poking out. They just know nothing about it, which is why there was such great engagement with the programme that we actually made. People learned a lot and wanted to know more. So, yeah, absolutely wholeheartedly, we need to talk more about Antarctica.
Thank you. So, if may
yeah, so the EU-PolarNet project, as well as the European Polar Board, are bipolar, so... No, I don't know another word for it. I mean, is there another word? Every time I say it or we say it, people start to laugh, but I'm serious. I mean, Antarctic as well as Arctic. One last comment, Los Otto, and the microphone is coming down.
Okay. And also operation from Arctic Monitoring Assessment Program. We have produced heavy scientific assessments over the last 55 years. And one of the key problems we have is the communication to the voters. We have produced a lot of recommendations to policymakers. We have piles, everything is based on science, involved indigenous people, but we don't get it out to the media. It's a major problem to get the attention of BBC, because they run their program. They have their fantastic journalists that goes to Antarctica and Arctic, and they are not interested in your comment. It's all in there. They have had our front page last week, so it's gone. That's a significant problem. Why do so many people be skeptic? One of the problems is that we haven't managed to communicate the science in a simple way to normal people who vote the skeptics, politicians, to be their political leaders. Another thing, one comment, don't expect too much from Finland.
Okay.
It's not that Finland is a bad country. Finland has been great. It's thanks to Finland that we have the Arctic Cooperation, because they took the signal from Gorbachev and said we have to do it now, and Gorbachev is calling for an Arctic ocean of peace and science. Finland took it and made it into their own new process. Today we have the Arctic Council. But we have a system in the Arctic Council where each country has a lead for 2 years, and they are their priority. And I've had big expectations when Canada took over, when Sweden took over, when the US took over, but they were very disappointed in the end, because they didn't get the long-term commitment to do this over time and to bring in the resources. So they left us, we were doing this simple work, to collect the funding, to collect the scientists and get it done. So that is a big challenge for Arctic Council and the future, to look into the future and see what is needed on the long term. And what Tom said, we need to work together with actions with the stakeholders. That has been the last point I take up. The challenge to really bringing the stakeholders to the table. Indigenous people have been there since day one, but to get in the industry, the oil industry are thinking 10 years ahead. The mining industry, but when you come to small business, they don't think more than 2 years. So we're doing a spiritual adaptation to a changing market. And the big problem has been the involvement of stakeholders.
So
that's a challenge.
Thank you. Now, time is actually out, but...
Yes.
Okay, so one last in the audience and then one quick one from Tero.
Yes, my name is Gjordan Sylte. I'm from the Bjerknes Center for Climate Research, and I'm doing the communications at our Climate Research Center. So I'm very happy that the communication part has been so largely in this panel. And so I have actually a concrete question for the IPCC. Like, now we've been talking about the communication, and the IPCC has met some criticism on the communication of the results. So I'm just wondering if you have some strategy for the communication work here. And also, I'm very happy to hear what that Thomas Armstrong talked about, the gap between the science and the decision makers. And the challenge is to get them on board and how to get them along. And so I'm wondering, is the IPCC and the assessment reports, is that an area where you could kind of get the decision makers more on board?
So I will decide now. Valérie, you can respond from an IPCC perspective on the very important communication part. And then Tero has 3 seconds, and then we will wrap up. And during lunch, we will pick up this question on Finland. Okay. Valérie.
A very quick answer to a very important point. There was an IPCC workshop in Norway on communication. We have lessons learned and a few options that still need to be implemented to improve some aspects related to communication. And one first thing that has been implemented is launching pre-scoping surveys with respect to the topics of the various reports, so that those who are outside of the scoping meetings, the national focal points, the observing organizations, those familiar with the social networks with the IPCC, have contact with the process and can provide insights for the process from the beginning. Thank you.
Thank you, Andrew. 3 second thing from Tero before I wrap up.
Yeah, on the continuum and the great hockey game between Sweden and Finland. So if you think of the issue that it's 2 years periods only, well, we've been approached, or Finland has been approached by the United States that it would be great if we would continue these and those types of issues which were on the chairmanship program. And this is of course a Pan-Arctic issue, this is not a Finnish issue. However, we've been addressing this in the Arctic Economic Council already, so there will be no specific chairmanship period program for Finland on the Arctic Economic Council. We have implemented a strategy for the next 3 years, and we will follow that strategy, whoever is chair.
Thank you, Tero. And now, the wrap-up and the very, and I mean quick, from each panelist, we were invited to reflect and present on what does the European society need from polar research. And each panelist should choose a receiver and an advice or a message in a very quick manner. And Tom grabbed the microphone.
It was thrown at me.
Okay. Your receiver and your advice, Tom. Receiver of the message.
Well, the receiver of the message should be everybody in charge of their own nation's climate change programs.
Okay, and the advice is?
And the advice is this, and it gets back to your question. I used to run a $2.5 billion U.S. program on climate change, the largest single climate change research program in the world. 4 different goals, I'm going to go through them. One of the major 4 goals was communicate and educate results to the public. You know how many dollars went into that? 0. And it's one of the 4 major goals. Enough said. We need a boundary organization is what these European countries, what we all need. We need a bridge between science and decision making that effectively includes communication, not just media, but all forms of communication and education, as well as assessment, research, and observations.
Thank you. And Tero?
I will pick up one of my 3 conclusions, and I will address it to Ban Ki-moon and also to the heads of the OECD. So we discussed about the economical issues regarding the Arctic and the problem how to invest. So the message would be that let's continue and improve the research on how to introduce funding mechanisms whereas added value isn't available in the Arctic due to lack of economics of scales.
Yeah, thank you. And Peter, your receiver and your message.
Well, with an introduction. The very influential researcher Noam Chomsky, he's now 87 years old, said in an interview last month that isn't it ironic that 100 years ago we believed that indigenous cultures were so weak that they could not survive in this world. And today we know that they are the knowledge holders that has the capacity to make humankind survive. The message to not only the European but the global society is, time is not a straight line of perpetual development. Time is circular. What goes around comes around.
Thank you. Valérie.
I would like to
speak to educators of children of all ages, from preschool to university level, and I would like to suggest them to use the polar region as inspiring examples, showing the beauty and the risks, the discovery and the historical and new knowledge, and the connection between all parts of the world.
Thank you. And Peter?
I'd like to talk to all communicators. We heard a comment there that if we can just explain the facts, then everybody will understand and everything will be okay. We think like that as scientists. Most normal people don't actually think that way. They think emotionally. I think, so yes, we have to get the science message out there, but put Jannie in front of a camera and explain the human impact, and a lot more people will also take on that message.
Thank you, Jannie.
I speak to my brothers and sisters all over the globe, saying we are still here. Keep on fighting.
Thank you. I think we will have to give applause to this panel. I use the word have because we should applaud ourselves also being active. And as a humble gesture of our appreciation, Nicole, there is a bag for each panelist, okay, that you now will deliver, or...
And I would like to thank all of you for this excellent panel on behalf of the EU-PolarNet. It was really, really interesting to listen to this. Thank you very much for coming.
Practical instructions now. Nicole, will you give us some practical instructions? What will happen now?
We have a lunch break now. Lunch is served in the same room where we had the coffee break. And we should be back at 1:45. Thank you.